everyone, thank you so much for being here. As Murtaza said, we all are in the midst of a great challenge to humanity. And the fact that we can gather and promote peace and economic welfare and the welfare of the environment and our world in the midst of this difficult time is truly amazing and truly a feat. Thank you so much. I want to give special thanks to the city of Tokat, which has been for a very short time our home. It's an amazing place. You can look around and see that. As the mayor said, there's a lot of history here, which we've been enjoying. We are grateful to the governor, grateful to the mayor, grateful to the government, and all of you here, the ambassadors, the exhibitors, people who are guests, you're welcome. And I can say that even though I'm not from Tokat. I know that the famous Turkish hospitality, which I've enjoyed, I know you all will enjoy as well. So welcome very much. I want to start with what ecotourism is. We've been talking a lot about it today. And first, I'll tell you why I can say that. As the executive director of the International Ecotourism Society, I can tell you that our definition is used by a little more than half the world. The UNTO and the United Nations use our definition. Our definition is in the New York Times, it's in Africa, it's in five continents. It's used by 90 different countries to implement ecotourism. And one of the reasons we think that's important is because, sorry about that. It's right there. Responsible travel to natural areas that conserves the environment and improves the well-being of local people. That's one simple sentence, but it has so much. And every word in that sentence is important. Thais is, we're now in our, oh, sure. Okay. Thais is, we're now in our 30th year. We have over 15,000 members worldwide in 190 plus countries. That number is always growing. So, you know, it may be over 200 at this point. This definition guides implementation globally. As I said, it's been quoted in all the major periodicals, and it's used internationally as a way to create positive ecotourism. Responsible travel to natural areas that conserves the environment, sustains the well-being of local people, and involves interpretation and education. The first part of that is the well-being of local people. The communities in which the travel takes place are critically important to the success of ecotourism. And why ecotourism is growing, why it's making so much of a difference around the globe, is that sentence. It means that we're not thinking just about the tourists or about the revenue. We're thinking about everyone in the ecosystem. We're thinking about the local people, the communities, the traditions, the history, the environment. That's all incredibly important. And there's a reason why this really matters right now. So these are the things that ecotourism must have. The community must have a real voice and real power in tourism decisions. Decisions must involve community, government, experts, funders, and developers. Development must positively affect ecosystems and climate. And the legacy of the tourism must benefit community and ecosystems. And what exactly does that mean? Positively affect. In other words, as the Latin statement goes, primum non nuncere, at first do no harm, isn't good enough. It isn't good enough to say, well, we won't harm anyone. We must have a positive effect. And here's why. Right now, these are just a couple of headlines, but it shows you a very important trend. Right now, all over the world, there are investments in sustainability. And sustainable tourism is one of usually the five or six main categories of sustainable practice. It's responsible for the GDP of more than 50% of the GDP of more than 25 nations on this earth. And responsible for the more than 50% of the foreign receipts of at least 50 nations on this earth. So 25% of the nations on this earth rely heavily on tourism for their foreign receipts. So there's a lot of investing now in green tourism. Look at that. Here we are in 2012, what is that, $3 billion? 9 years later, even through the pandemic, this year, the European Union will invest more in sustainable development than the entire world did in 2018. It's growing every year 25%, as Murtaza pointed out to you. And what does this mean for us? Right? People are starting to notice it, aren't they? Private sector, NGOs, large global organizations. First of all, when there is sustainable investment, there's a what they call a greenium. You're not going to be able to translate that. Just let it be greenium. That means that people will pay more, investors will pay more and expect less return from a sustainable investment. Green bonds attract a broader range of investors, meaning people want to get involved in sustainability. They want to have a positive effect. New green bonds are heavily oversubscribed. What that means is we're seeing when a bond issue is done, we're seeing lots of people want to be involved. Why? Because we're building sustainability. We're growing investment. The EU has an action plan on financing sustainable growth. Now that plan is global. Larry Fink here, a fundamental reshaping of finance. You know who Larry Fink is? He's the CEO of BlackRock, which is the largest hedge fund in the world. And they're calling it the next mega trend. Our business, travel, sustainable travel, is now something that the global community is paying attention to. Here's another thing. Portugal, is there anyone here from Portugal? No? So we have, oh, yeah. Oh, hi, hello, how are you? So they're going to implement the green visa, which means when there's green investment, it's like the US's, you know, golden visa. When you invest so much, you get an automatic visa. And they interviewed me about it. They said, John, what do you think about this? And I said, the way I see it, green visas might be good for ecotourism if, and only if, there is sufficient real oversight. And who does that oversight? Who's doing that oversight for us? You see these guys on the front row up here? The governors, the mayors? They're the one who's helping us make that possible. So the fact that they're here, the fact that we have such interest, is what makes it possible to have these kinds of programs and have them be successful. Mm-hmm. This is a difficult one. This is pre-COVID, pre-COVID travel. You can see travel before COVID was the fastest growing of the top 10 industries globally, and the only one that grew in 19 of the last 20 years. It outgrew every other industry. And it's one of two C2C industries, retail travel, business travel. When you travel, you can travel to a very small person, and you yourself go there, and you spread revenue around the world. So it's one of the most efficient methods for spreading revenue. At this point, we would be at, we'd have grown another 10% most likely without COVID. But what we know is that there's a lot of pent-up demand, and people will be traveling again. You'll see that strong economic growth continue dramatically in a few years. Now let's look at ecotourism, again, pre-COVID, because we don't have the latest figures, and also we know they're not going to be that great, but we also know we'll come back from this. Ecotourism in 2019, the UNWTO said it was a $1 trillion business. We say it's only 800 billion. We're a little less enthusiastic. But at the same time, we know it's a growing business. Ecotourism employs 11 million people directly globally. It's growing anywhere from 10% to 12% on an annualized basis, the fastest growing segment of tourism, and still is. Post-pandemic, it's growing even faster. As Murtaza said, it now makes up, sustainable tourism and ecotourism now make up 45% of the growth. Meaning that traditional tourism is kind of growing along like this. Sustainable tourism and ecotourism are growing like this. They're growing faster, they're outstripping the growth rate of every other segment. Eco-travelers are younger than the average traveler and are more committed to sustainable practices. 71% of the people under 35 want to travel sustainably. That's one of their top three priorities. And anybody, well, most of us are in this business, so we understand that the top three is where something happens. If it's in a person's top three priorities, then it's gonna happen. Eco-travelers cost less in infrastructure per unit revenue than any other type of traveler. Way less expensive than luxury travelers. Less expensive than traditional travelers. Less expensive than sports travelers. Ninety nations now have an ecotourism or sustainable tourism initiative nationally or at a regional level. And this has happened in the last 30 years. Most of them are using our definition to create that ecotourism within their country. Travelers have increased by 30%. And ecotourism is now the preferred travel experience for many major conservation NGOs, and that's important because people pay attention to IUCN. They pay attention to the large conservation organizations, WWF and those. And they all say the only form of tourism that they advocate for is ecotourism. That makes a difference because the consumer sees that and they decide, well, I want to do that. I want to make a positive difference. So I'm sorry to do this because I know this is a little bit technical, but I think you'll enjoy this. I'll try to make it entertaining. Genuine sustainable practice is one of the main metrics for ecotourism. And why? What do we mean metrics? In other words, when I said, what is ecotourism? It's nice to have that definition, but what is it really? What is it on the ground? What is it when you see it with your eyes and experience it? What does it do? Genuine sustainable practice. In other words, care for the environment, care for people. Veritable, equitable economic benefit. In other words, is that money uplifting everyone? Self-administered economic viability. Kind of like what you see here if you walk around Tokat, you can see all the shops and people doing well. Happiness and welfare. Also, what you see here in Toka. Education and opportunity and thriving ecosystems. That means environments and people that are doing well. You can see those with your eyes. And the big question I get asked now, because a lot of people want more eco-travelers, is what do eco-travelers want? This line comes directly from a survey that we did and have done on a regular basis. What are you going to do when this pandemic is over? People are so desperate to get back out there. What are they going to do? What's the first thing you're going to do? And that's what they want to do. They want to go out with a small group of people and get out on the beach or go see some nature. Take off the mask, get out of the rooms, and go enjoy themselves. Get out in the sun, see some trees. They want to see a well-executed safety plan like we have out here. You can see an example of that. 70% of our erstwhile consumers are planning to travel as soon as they can. As soon as they have the opportunity to, they will. So we're going to see probably the travel infrastructure overloaded and packed full of irritable travelers again. Airline search data, we follow this closely, and we're actually partners with the major airline groups, and this data is dramatically up. People are searching the places that they want to go. But these are why ecotourism will continue to grow. Because travelers value people. They're tired of being alone, they're tired of being in a room, they're tired of seeing things on a computer screen. They want to see you and me again. They want to hear people's voices, they want to hear children, all of that. And they want to connect. They don't just want to go somewhere and see an edifice alone. They want the culture and the history and the people around it. They want all of it. They want to experience life. Yeah. And that's what we're going to give to them. So why should we listen to them? Why do we care about eco-travelers? Because they have the highest average spend. Well, you know, that's debatable. Some people will say, oh, it's luxury tourism. It depends on how you define luxury tourism. But you see, I took off the ESD and I just put high. They have a high average spend. Costa Rica made a significant investment, I'm sure everyone knows, in ecotourism, and their spend is the highest in South America at this point. 25% of Costa Rica is now a protected area. So protecting your environment does not negatively impact your tourism spend, your tourism revenue. Our travelers are respectful, law-abiding, and clean. They take care of nature, they do not. You know, there's always that one, but most of the time, I should say, they do not cause any problems. They're searching for experiences and not deals. They're not trying to get the lowest price. They're not trying to find the absolute bottom, whatever it is. They want an experience, and they're willing to pay for it. And they're willing to search for it. They're willing to go someplace they haven't gone before for it. They're willing to take a risk for it. They're more careful of the environment and ecosystems. And once you get them, they're pretty good at promotion for you. They'll help you promote your destination because they like to say, I went to this new place. So they're good travelers to have. Ecotourism has a low cost to implement. Doesn't cost a lot to build ecotourism infrastructure. It's one of the most efficient ways to begin tourism to a new area because you don't have to put in a lot of fancy stuff. Ecotourists are courageous. They will come to a place to see it. No required infrastructure, small groups and small operators, mostly self-financed. And here's one that's very important. The revenue remains in the country. The money that they make helps to grow villages helps to grow businesses in the local area. It's not shipped back out. They're responsive, and you'll see their rapid development. The travelers don't require luxury. They don't require, you know, everybody, well, what do German travelers expect? What do American travelers expect? You don't have to worry about that. Eco-travelers expect what's there. They want to see what's already there. And they spend more, as I said. What this brings us to is now is the time. Now is the time. We've got the support of the major NGOs, we've got the support of the UN, we've got the support of governments, we've got the support of people, we've got the support of travelers, we've got the support of academics, we've got the support of media. Sorry about that, that's a lot for me. Now is the time to implement sustainable natural tourism, to take care, to take the steps to take care of people, to take care of the environment, to build the peace that all of you who are here are already so good at building, to finish up each one of you's vision of a world where we take care of each other, we take care of our towns, we take care of our nature, we take care of our world. Thank you.